blessed us richly as a church. We have been able to reach out to so many this week for the firefighters and the sheriffs and the first aid responders. Father, as we just gave them a simple gift of cookies. Father, we thank you for that. We thank you that we've been able to reach out to the folks in Johnson City. And Father, we just lift up all of that to you and give you praise and glory for any good that comes out of those things. But Father, we also pray for our service today. We pray for souls to be saved, lives to be changed. In your name, amen. You know, we need to face facts. Christmas, for some, is a very, it's loved by a lot of people. And as a matter of fact, it is loved richly by a lot of people. It's also hated by just as many. You know, regardless of which side of the issue you fall on, this much is true. Christmas is filled with a lot of mixed emotions. Amen? Christmas is filled with a lot of mixed emotions, mixed messages, and a lot of worldly rituals that take place going on in the world today. As a matter of fact, it's supposed to be the time of the year when we remember the birth of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. But the problem is that the world has mingled and all of that has mingled into that story so many other things that it kind of muddies the water. Amen? It kind of muddies the water for us. And today, I want to set straight those things about Christmas, about what we do. Because there's some terrible misconceptions that are going on that surround Christmas. As a matter of fact, to a lot of folks, it's all about money. It's commercialism. It's greed. And those are the things that I can't stand about Christmas. Now, I enjoy giving gifts. And I enjoy, most of the time, to receive gifts. But the thing about it is that's what a lot of people think this whole season is all about. A lot of people think it's all about the giving and the getting. Some people think it's all about the getting. When you're about this high, it's all about the getting. Amen? Yeah, man, you're over at mom's house, you know. So Santa comes to mom and dad's house. Then you go over to grandma and grandpa's house. And they, well, what do you know? There's presents under their tree, too. Then you go to the other granny and grampy's house, and guess what? There's some there, too. And then if you have crazy aunts and uncles, there's presents there, too. I have just described my entire family Christmas to you right there. And so a lot of people misconstrue what takes place. You know, there's a lot of folks that also think it's just a time for parties and meals and get-togethers. But that's not it either. Many children know Christmas as only Santa Claus, Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. And as a result, a lot of children even have no idea the true meaning of what Christmas is about. Little boy came home from Sunday school and he had just learned about the wise man paying a visit to Jesus. And he says, Mom, I found out that Christmas was not all those things. It's not about Santa Claus, and it's not about Rudolph, and it's not about any of those things. It was about these guys that came, and they saw that Jesus was the Savior, and they were bringing him gifts, and they even had to watch a big spotlight in the sky to see where they were going. And somebody a long time ago compared Santa to the Lord Jesus Christ. Yeah. Here's what it is. And here, let me read it. So they say Santa lives in the North Pole, but Jesus lives everywhere. Santa rides in a sleigh, but Jesus rides the wind and walks on the water. You know, Santa comes once a year, but Jesus is our ever-present help. You know, Santa comes down our chimney, but Jesus stands at your heart's door and knocks. You know, Santa fills your stockings with goodies. Jesus supplies all your needs. Santa lets you sit in his lap. Jesus holds you in his hands. Santa has a belly like a bowl of jelly, but Jesus has a heart of love. Santa's little helpers make new toys. Jesus makes new lives. And Santa puts gifts under your tree. But Jesus became our gift when he died on a tree. And I just thank God for the Bible. You know, in his holy, inspired, infallible word. Holy, inspired, infallible word. God sets the record straight where Christmas is concerned. Now, there's a lot of folks that say, yeah, Brother Don, It's not about all those things that you said. Jesus is the reason for the season. And yes, He is the main reason, but there's more reasons than that one. And we're going to get into those today. So here we go. If you're taking notes, I think I put notes in your little bulletin. If you're not, that's okay. And if I miss one, I'm sorry, you can come to me later. But number one, you know, Christmas is a time for giving. Forgiving. God, it's a time for God to give His Son to men. In verse 11, we see that the angels come and they approach the shepherds. Interesting group, these shepherds. We see that He came to them, that he told them that a Savior was coming. And not only that, but it would be the only begotten Son of Jesus, of God the Father. The only begotten Son that He was going to be given up for you and for I to have eternal life. What an announcement that was. God gave Jesus up to die on the cross so that our sin debt would not be charged to us, but would be paid for on that cross. What an amazing Savior we have. I want to tell you something, friends. You can follow any false god, and we talked about some. Chris talked about some this morning. And I want to tell you something. Nice people. But I want to tell you, every one of those gods demands something from you. Jesus Christ was the only one that came and died for you, where we do nothing but accept that free gift. You say, well, that's just a bad thing. No, it's not a bad thing, because the Bible says we can't do it on our own. Well, there is nothing good in us, friends, nothing. Until Jesus came and died for you and for me, and He saved us from an eternity in hell. And I thank God for giving that amazing, amazing gift to you and I. Friends, the cradle was the first stop on the road that ends at the cross. Now, it's also a time for men to give their souls to God. Friends, nobody likes to receive a gift usually and then give nothing in return. Anybody ever do that? Somebody surprises you with a gift, and then you feel like you have to go and give them one. Anybody ever do that?
Yeah.
It's almost like human nature. We don't want to receive anything that we haven't. We want to give something as well. You know, God gave His Son to die for sinners. And if we're to give a gift to the Lord, what would it be? What would it be? Well, there are two groups in connection with the birth and the early life of the Lord Jesus Christ. Did you know that? There's two of them. First are the shepherds. But the other ones are the wise men. Somebody says there were three wise men. The Bible's not specific, right? There may very well have been three, but there could have been a whole lot more. But we know that they were wise men. Now, I'll ask you a question. How many of you have at least one person on your Christmas list that you just can't seem to find or buy anything for? It's almost like they have it. It's like, what do you give somebody that already has everything? Think about it. So I started to think about, what kind of gift could I give God? And I said, all right, I'll give Him my money. He don't need my money. You know, sometimes we do the easy approach, right? We slip a little money into an envelope and say, Merry Christmas, and we didn't go to the mall, and we're okay, or wherever, you know? You know, He can get by without our talents and our money. He doesn't need a fruit basket. He doesn't need a new tie. He doesn't need socks or handkerchiefs. In fact, if you get right down to us, none of us really possess anything anyway. Somebody says, I own my home. Quit making the house payments. Well, I own it. I don't owe the bank nothing. Fine, quit paying the taxes. Yeah, see who owns it then. Or let them put a special project through your neighborhood and see how long you keep your house. He said, well, I own my cars. No, you don't. Stop. Stop putting taxes, paying the taxes. Stop paying the insurance on them. See what happens. You say, well, I own my own money. Well, until the economy crashes. Amen? Think about it. We all had a lot of money before the last dip in the stock market. We thought, woohoo, retirement. And then the dip took place and we said, woohoo, greener at Walmart. That's, you know, I'm not doubting that. I'm just saying that's what happened. That's what's going to happen to us. And now we're like, please, please stay this way, right? No. The only thing that we can truly, that is truly ours is our soul. You know, you have control over it. The only gift we can give God is our soul. It's the only thing that I have that I can honestly give. That's it. Now the question arises, have you given your heart to the Lord? Because if not, there's no better time to do it than today. You know, there's a lot of folks that in the world today, they say, well, I need money, I need cars, I need this, I want. Okay, fine, you get it, you got everything you want. Right? Then what? Well, Mark 8:36 comes in and says, for what shall it profit a man if he should gain the whole world and lose his own soul? For what price shall a man pay for his soul? And so the question is, how cheaply have you sold out your soul? Yeah? How cheaply have you done that? And the question is, my friends, have you given your heart, your life, but your soul, have you given it to God? You know, 2 Corinthians 6:2 says something very similar to this. You know, behold, today is the day of salvation, not tomorrow. Not the next day. It wasn't yesterday, or else you'd be saved today. But today. Why? Because you do not know what tomorrow brings. I'm here to tell you, friends, I have talked to many folks in the funeral homes, many folks in the hospitals, many folks that have said, you know what? If I'd have known this 3 weeks ago, I wouldn't have lived this 3 weeks out. And it happens so quickly. And it hits us so hard. We do not know how much time we have here on this earth, but I'll tell you something. God does. And if we've placed our faith, hope, and trust in Him, and we've accepted that gift of salvation, He holds us in His hands. And we need not fear death. So Christmas is a time for giving, but it's also a time for good tidings. In verse 10, we see the angels say they brought a message of good tidings. As a matter of fact, that translates to evangelism. That's how they were evangelizing. The word evangelize comes from that word there, good tidings. And the message of the angel was a message of salvation. He came to proclaim the glorious news that a Savior had been born in Bethlehem. Now, the message is really a message of hope. And as has been mentioned in other messages, as we go back to the shepherds, the shepherds were social outcasts. The shepherds were people that were deemed unclean by their own religion. As a matter of fact, these men were very vulgar and crass, probably, and that they lived to themselves. They were really social outcasts. But the Lord Jesus Christ saw fit to announce His birth to them first. And I say, praise God, because if the shepherds could be announced the hope of salvation, then that hope of salvation applies to me, and it applies to you, and it brings hope to this lost and dying world. All the 5 billion people that Celia was saying earlier that are not saved, boy, it brings hope to everybody when you bring it. And it's amazing. They were forbidden from seeking God in the temple. So God brought salvation to them. Oh, that's good. Yeah, that's good. Oh, brother, you know how to put it in there, don't you? Woo! Good preaching. Friends, the message hasn't changed. It has not changed in all the years. It is still a message of hope. And you may be somebody that says, I've committed all the most terrible sins there are to commit. And I'm here to tell you, you may feel that God would not save you. You may feel you have no hope. You may think you're beyond the scope of saving power. Well, let me tell you this morning that Jesus Christ is the door of salvation. And He's knocking on your door and He's saying, open the door and I'll come into you. And ooh, that's good, ain't it? And if we just give Him our soul, we will find that salvation in Him. Here's the deal. If you're lost and you know you need a Savior, then know that Jesus is all you need. He is all you need. And just as the message was one of hope for those men that night, this message today is a hope for us. It is a hope for our family. It is a hope for our friends. It is a hope for the ones that we don't want to see die and go to hell. It's a message of hope. And why are we not sharing it ever more everywhere we go? Again, yesterday we had the privilege of going to Johnson City. And we were able to give a little hope to those that were, for the most part, feeling hopeless. A simple gift of clothing. A simple gift of a little backpack filled with things. And those children were saying, I can go back to school now. How much more hope can we bring when we carry the love of Christ to this lost and dying world? And give them that precious, sweet gospel of Christ. Well, it's a time for giving, a time for good tidings. It's also a time for amazing grace. It's a time for amazing grace. Friends, in a very real sense, you know, we really are the reason for the season. Now, there's a lot of people who say, Brother Don, you're being a heretic. And I said, nope. Many people don't even know what that word is, so I'm not that. No, I'm kidding. I'm not being blasphemous. It's really true. Jesus came for you and for me. He came for every one of us. Amen? He came to die on the cross. He came to bear that sin debt that we could not possibly bear. He died for you and for me. Now, these miserable shepherds didn't deserve a thing. But they were the first to hear of Christ's birth. Grace is the unmerited love and favor of God towards sinners. And everything we have, every blessing we have is unmerited. We didn't earn it. We didn't deserve it. And just as it was with those shepherds, if there is salvation in your life and mine, it is by grace and grace alone. Not of anything we've ever done. In fact, if we got what we deserved, it would have to be according to Romans 6:23 that says, for the wages of sin is death. And that word death there translates hell. We deserve nothing but hell. There's a lot of people that will get mad at me for saying, Brother Don, I can't believe you said that. I'm a good, honest church member. I'm a good person. I'm a good this. I'm a good that. And I want to tell you something. Ephesians 2:8-9. Go read it. Study it. Commit it to memory. Put it in your heart. Because the Bible says that none of us can save ourselves. It was by grace and grace alone. By grace and grace alone. My dear lost friends, if you ever experience salvation, it will not be on anything good that you've done. It is not anything good that you have done. It is not anything good that I have done. It is by grace and grace alone. And God said it is available for all. Whosoever. I'm a whosoever. Every time I look at that verse, for whosoever... excuse me, shall call upon the name of the Lord, shall be saved. And I'm glad to tell you, I'm a whosoever. Friends, don't presume on the Lord. Don't presume that you have days, months, years left. Don't do it, because there may never be another opportunity. Well, we see it's a time for giving and good tidings and grace. But we see that it's a time for glorifying God. That's good too. See, after the first angel finished the speech, then the real praising started. Amen? First angel stands up there and says, glory to God, the birth of Jesus is on the rise, and I firmly believe all of heaven's glory was displayed to those shepherds that night. And they said, glory, glory to God. And the shouts, can you imagine the praising that was echoing off of the hills and the mountains and the valleys? And they had never seen anything such like that. On display. Those angels were just a praising away. Please notice what they did not say. Theirs was a spiritual message, not a secular one. They didn't sing at the top of their lungs, "Santa Claus is coming to town," right? They said, "A Savior is coming, which is Christ the Lord." Friends, I want to remind you, Christmas, and along with Easter, minus the Easter Bunny, of course, are tremendous times for the children of God to demonstrate their faith. More people pay more attention during Easter and Christmas than any other time, usually during the year. And we have that opportunity to be that witness for Christ. We have the opportunity, as 1 Corinthians 10:31 says, whatever we do, eat, drink, anything we do all to the glory of God. And when we do it all to the glory of God and live that out in front of folks, it'll be the salt, it'll be the light of the world, and people are going to want to come to Jesus. So it's a time to glorify God. Five, Christmas is a time for going home. You know, on that first Christmas, Joseph returned to the ancient home of his forefathers. And for Mary and Joseph, it really was a time for going home. You know, there's just nothing like being home. Amen? You go on a long trip, and you enjoy, maybe on vacation, you even enjoy the vacation, say, "Boy, I'd love to live here." Then you say, "Boy, I miss home." Right? It's a certain amount of days. It doesn't matter which one. Now, if you're staying with family, they choose that day, which is within 2 or 3 days after your first arrival. Now, if you're on vacation by yourselves, then you choose that day some other time, maybe a week or two, before you get tired of each other. But you still want to go home. And there's nothing like being home. Now, many of us will go and visit parents and relatives during the holiday season, travel great distances, and that'll make a Christmas very special. It really will. But may I say to you who are gathered with us today that there are some of you who need to go home this Christmas, just like the prodigal son. Friends, you've wandered from the Father's house and lived out in the far country, but it's now time for you to come home. So, Brother Don, I don't know what to find. If I come home to Jesus, you'll find forgiveness. You'll find love. You'll find acceptance. All of those things you won't find in the world. It's really hard. People work hard to be accepted by others. Y'all ever notice that? People work real hard to do that. By the way they dress, especially in school, high school. Oh my gosh. I mean, if somebody makes fun of you for the way you're dressed, then you try to dress different to be just like them. Why would you want to be like somebody so mean and ugly anyway? Oh. Brother Don, I bet you did that in high school. I bet I didn't. Hey, it's deep-seated in me. I've been this way all my life. I'm sorry, that's just how it is. I was not about to let somebody else tell me how I should dress. Now, if somebody was wearing something, I said, "Yeah, that's pretty good. That might look good on me." So I tried. If I didn't think it looked good on me, I'd say, it's worth a try. But it sure wasn't for somebody else. And it sure wasn't for somebody I'm trying to be like. And then after I was saved, I wanted to be like Jesus. And so it didn't matter what I wore. But what did matter is that I was modest. What did matter is that the way I dressed brought glory to God, right? And not to others. Right? It let everybody look at my eyes, right? Said, "Well, you're a guy, not a girl." I said, "I don't care." The thing is, we dress to impress, we dress to make ourselves provocative, we do whatever we can. I'm here to tell you, my friends, it doesn't matter. Why are we doing that? Why? Acceptance is a big thing in the world today. But I want to tell you something. Jesus says, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." Doesn't matter how you look. Doesn't matter how you dress. Friends, he says, "Come as you are." Well, Brother Don, I've got to clean up my act first. I've got to do this first. I've got to do that first. And I'm here to tell you, that is the Holy Spirit touching your heart about a need for a Savior. You can't clean up before, right? But I want to tell you something. When you give your heart and life to Christ, you'll want to. And He'll give you that. He'll touch your heart about everything in your life that needs changing. And it is not because of what somebody else has said that you need to change. That Holy Spirit is more than enough mouthpiece to let you know. And I want to tell you something. That old fella in the prodigal son, he was feeding the pigs, and he was a Jew. The most unclean of all the animals, and he was hanging around in the slop bin with them. But his father saw him, wrapped him in the robe to represent his cleanliness. So they saw him. Friends, there's others who have never even met the Father. Friends, your greatest need is to come home for the holidays. God's offer of salvation is available to everybody. Now, I'm sure there's many other reasons for the season that we could find in the Word of God, but let these stand as a reminder to us. The greatest need this season, and for that matter, in any season, is for men to have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. My prevailing heartstrings were pulled every time I talked to somebody yesterday. And all I wanted to know is if they're saved. That's all I care. You say, Brother Don, you didn't care about the clothes they got or this they got? Oh, that's okay, but that's just a means to an end, right? That's just to open their heart. That's just to get, hey, that's just to let them know that we love them with Christ's love. And now I'm going to share the real thing with you. That's all it was. That's it. Friends, I invite you to come if you have strayed in your walk from the Lord Jesus Christ in the invitation time. You can come and repent of that and give that to Him at this altar. If there's areas in your life that you need to follow God in obedience, come. Give it to Him. And if there's some here today that say, Brother Don, I truly need to be saved, meet me here at the front. And we'll open God's precious, holy Word. We'll show you what it is to be saved. Amen. What has God talked to your heart about today?